Again, it's made of carbon atoms which are arranged in the honeycomb lattice. And so on. The distance between the carbon atoms is 0.142 nanometers. The angle is 120 degrees. And this is, again, let's say this is y and this is x-axis in this case. And now we can discuss what is this lattice actually. So this hexagonal or honeycomb lattice. Is not a Bravais lattice, right? So just a reminder. Bravais lattice is a lattice where you have a lattice generating vector. So let's say this is your lattice generating vector, and you can then represent it in terms of some integer numbers, and the lattice. And the basis vectors in two dimensions. Those are two basis vectors. So you have n1 and n2, they are integers, and the a1, a2 are vectors of dimension 2. So these are basis vectors. And now you can actually quite clearly see why this lattice is not a Bravais lattice. Let me add a little bit more on the carbon atoms. So this thing kind of continues and so on. Let's take the central piece and look at it more carefully. So you have one carbon atom here, and I'm just replicating the middle section. So this is if you look at this carbon atom. You see, this one has one neighbor on the left and the two neighbors on the right, right? So this two neighbors on the right, one neighbor on the left. But this one has actually two neighbors on the left and one neighbor on the right, right? And there is no way by doing this kind of transformation, if you take this carbon atom, there is no way you can, by simply tiling this this section, and in direction, there is no way you can recreate this one. So you cannot change the number of neighbors. There's so they're topologically inconsistent. Those are mirror reflections of each other. So you have to introduce the mirror reflections, and that cannot be done in terms of simple lateral translations. So it's not a Bravais lattice, and this means we need to introduce a unit cell which contains more than one carbon atom. There are several ways, of course, how to do this. And let me clean up a little bit this structure. And let's change color. And one of the ways to do it, you take these midpoints, these four middle points, and then you generate this kind of rhombus, and that will be one of the examples of unit cell. So this is a unit cell of graphene, and it contains two carbon atoms. Sometimes they are labeled like A and B. You will see in a minute why. And then there will be two of these basis vectors, A1 and A2. So several ways to introduce them. Let's say A1 can be this. This is A1. And the A2 can be this one. And now you can see quite clearly that you can tile the entire two-dimensional plane with those rhombuses by simply translating the copies of them, you can tile the entire section and so on. So it's all kind of like now can be covered. And this is our, now it's a Bravais lattice, and It has two sublattices, which is this A and B parts here. And this type of lattice is called a bipartite lattice. And it has two triangular sublattices. So you can then see this one as this sublattice B. I can probably add a little bit more carbon atoms on this plot, and then I can color code different sublattices, and you can see that they form a set of triangular sublattices. Let's color code. Let's color code one of them with a blue color. So every second atom now is the sublattice B. Hope I won't make some mistakes. Right. And then you can join them together, and you will see that those are. This is a triangular lattice, and that's and that one is also this one is also a Bravais lattice, and then you have the same for the B. They will be kind of like interpenetrating, and. The probably quite a useful notion that these not unique bases, so you can have a different basis. This picture is a little bit messy, but we can maybe redraw it slightly differently. So you can actually now turn it. On the side. And you can have, for example, these two basis vectors, this one and this one. This will be A1, this will be A2. So they now, they have different angles slightly. And you can have, also it will be useful for our later considerations, the vectors which allow the translation from one of the carbon atoms to its nearest neighbors. So there is a three of them. For each carbon atom, you will have this delta 1, delta, maybe this one is delta 2, this delta 3, if we have x and y. And then you can write those basis vectors in terms of the x and y coordinates and the distance, and this a, the distance between the carbon atoms. So we can write it algebraically. So A1 is A0, the column vector, and A2 will be A half and square root of 3/2 A. Then you can, if we consider the area of our unit cell, so Wigner-Zeitz cell, I think. So this area, which contains two carbon atoms, you can calculate the area of the unit cell if you do some estimations for this one. It will be square root of 3/2 a², approximately 0.051 nanometer squared. Oops. Nanometer squared. So the number of carbon atoms in this unit cell will be 2 divided by the area of unit cell, and you will have approximately 39 per nanometer squared, or in terms of centimeter squared. So we were usually using the carrier density, the concentration of carriers per centimeter squared of the material. that will be 3.9 10 to 15 per centimeter minus 2. And this is the, because each carbon atom gives one pi electron, so the number of pi electrons will be this 3.9 10 to 15 centimeters minus 2. So this number, 3.9, is not equal to the density of charge carriers in graphene. So it's not equal to the N of carriers in graphene. We will see why. This is quite a big distinction. And I think that's all the introduction for the structure which we need for deriving the band structure of graphene. So it's the next part will be derivation of E as a function of a momentum.